Hi everybody, my name is Snap. In this video we're going to be talking about Aurobots, everything from leveling to end game to racing, how to build it, how to transition it. We're going to try and go through everything here. Keep in mind that this guide will primarily focus on softcore Aurobots. I am not a hardcore player. I haven't played hardcore in a very long time. So just keep in mind that most of the information in here will be focused on softcore and not hardcore. There is a list of timestamps down in the description, so if you're not interested in watching the entire guide or you're just interested in a particular section, just feel free to go down to the description there and click on a timestamp and you can just go right to that section. Just a really quick about me. I'm the leader of the Reddit Detectives slash Tencent Clan. The most recent race we played in was actually the Incursion Flashback event, which we won. We came in first place for overall, and that's my teammate Dahoon there, who was actually the one pushing on Deadeye. I'm also the one that was spamming your chat during the Delve League with the first depth. We were first 1,000, first 1,500, and then first 3,000, and then that's when we stopped. And then most recently, in the past few leagues, we've been magic finding, just trying to make as much currency as possible. And then there you can see in the corner just a quick screenshot of what our group wealth is like just after a week of playing. Okay, so jumping right into it, what is an Aurobot? Why do people play them, and what do they even do? Aurobots stack mana reservation on gear and the tree to try and run as many auras as they possibly can. They stack aura effectiveness on gear and the tree to try and have more powerful auras than you would normally have alone. They actually don't do any damage themselves. Their primary purpose is to just buff the tankiness and buff the damage of nearby party members. Typically, they are energy shield based because most of the gear lends itself to ES, and also going ES lends you to have a higher effective life pool. There are a lot of reasons why people play Aurobot in the first place. They typically increase the damage for the carry, especially for projectiles. And if you build them correctly, they can triple or even quadruple the damage of every person you're supporting. They also offer increased survivability. Using a purity aura of each element, we can boost all of our maximum elemental resistances for us and the party from 75 all the way to 84, which is a gigantic reduction in damage. And when you properly invest in Grace and Vol Grace, they can provide an insane layer of defense for everybody that you're in range of. Most builds can't afford to squeeze in Grace or Vol Grace into their build, so being able to give upwards of 20,000 evasion and capped 75% dodge and spell dodge is really invaluable as a defensive layer. On top of all these bonuses you can provide to your party, Aurobots are typically very cheap to build, especially after the first couple days of the league. Many build-enabling items for Aurobots typically drop down into the 1 or 2 chaos price range, and you can get a functional Aurobot build for endgame maps, probably spending maybe 10 to 20 chaos. Aurobots can carry mid-game lulls in power, typically from T5 to T10 maps, and they can also carry the damage of teammates who want to wear many pieces of item quantity gear. There are three main variants of Aurobot that people like to play, one of them being the most common, which is the low-life Shavs version, the second being a Victarios version, and the third is a Mana Guardian hybrid. There are pros and cons to each variant of Aurobot, and we're going to start off with the most common, which is the low-life Scion Chevrons version. It's the most well-rounded support, and it has the best mix of offense and defense. It's the easiest to gear and works well in League Start and racing scenarios. However, it's not highly specialized, so other Aurobots can provide more damage via Victarios, and Mana Guardians can provide more survivability via the Mana Guardian buff. The second version, which revolves around using the Victarios chest, typically can achieve much higher damage numbers than the Shavs version can. However, it requires a high amount of micro to play, requiring a flask to keep you alive. It's usually very clunky to play and susceptible to Nullifier Nemesis mods. It's hard to play in very long sessions, as this version requires constant micro. The third version, the Mana Guardian version, is typically built for hardcore because of its insane energy shield bonus, but it can't run many offensive auras because it has to focus on getting a lot of mana instead. The next few sections of this guide will begin to focus on leveling and how to transition your leveling into an endgame aura support. While this guide isn't going to give you every single little detail about your leveling process, I am going to try and give you an overarching guide on what to do at what level and what to look out for while leveling. In the video description, I'm going to be leaving our full 3-hour-long VOD of what a typical leveling process will look like with full completion. So if you need something to reference during your own leveling process, be sure to check out that VOD. It might answer any questions you might have. Okay, so starting with the passive tree, I'm going to leave a path of building link in the description of this video. And when you open this path of building link, it will have all of the skill trees set in stages here, and it will have the according levels here at the top. So you can scroll through here at the bottom and see what the passive tree develops into at each stage. Please keep in mind there are a lot of ways to level a build like this. This is just what I found to be personally most efficient and the fastest when building an Aurobot on League Start. Starting levels 1 through 15, you're going to start going through these spell damage nodes here. You're going to grab Harrier and then book it all the way down here to the Crackling Speed nodes. The reason we want to grab these Crackling Speed nodes is because we're going to be using the very, very flavor of the month broken skill, Stormbrand. Stormbrand is unlocked at level 12. Once you reach Act 2, so you want to pick it up as soon as you reach Act 2, and then from levels 12 through 24, you want to be using Stormbrand. The level at which you can transform your build into a full aura build is actually level 24. So once you grab these Crackling Speed nodes, your next destination is to hit these two aura clusters, Influence and Leadership. So you have the first two aura clusters, you have two main destinations before doing your first labyrinth. You want to grab Elemental Equilibrium, and you want to grab Charisma before doing your first lab. This will allow you to run three auras, typically Anger, Wrath, and then Purity of Elements, as well as Smite. So you've completed your first lab and you have Elemental Equilibrium and Charisma, you do have some access to some life nodes here, and your next destination is to go over to the Sovereignty Wheel, going up through these nodes here. You can pick up Mind Over Matter for 1 point here. It's free, it can add to your tankiness a little bit, even though you are reserving most of your mana, but it's just 1 point, you can grab it just for a little bit of extra tankiness. Once you've filled out the Sovereignty Cluster here, you're probably feeling a little bit squishy, you're probably Act 6, maybe 7, around level 55, something like that. You do have access to these life nodes here, as well as this life node here. Something that Scions can utilize is getting all of these Elemental Resist nodes down here, and depending on what kind of gear you're picking up along the way, spending these 5 points to grab all of this Elemental Resistance is something that can cap you off very early. Your next destination is to head down towards Blood Magic, but you probably don't have the ES gear to be able to make the transition quite yet, so you're just going to go really quick past it and then grab Champion of the Cause, the last aura cluster you need to grab. Next stage of the passive tree is what I like to call the ES transition. This typically happens at level 68. That's when you can equip Prism Guardian, that's the highest level requirement, and then this allows you to run more auras when you take Mortal Conviction, as well as you unspec a lot of these previous life clusters we have here. This previous life cluster we had here, and we're going to start taking some ES clusters, specifically in Witch and this Unnatural Calm cluster right here. From here, it's just really picking up as much energy shield as we can. We already have all the aura nodes, so we're going to be picking up this ES cluster here, this ES cluster here, which also gives us some resistances. We can probably at this point unspec all of our resist nodes here, because at this point we'll be running triple purity, and then you can fill out this energy shield cluster here. Another viable option is to go up and grab the alchemist nodes, which I really like, and then also this essence surge node, which helps with your ES recharge. Many of you might notice that I am not taking the Zealot's Oath Keystone, and there are a few reasons for this. The first reason is cost. It is much cheaper to build a Scion support without Zealot's Oath than with. The reason for that is because you need one of two things. You need a Watcher's Eye that has a clarity mod that reduces the amount of mana you use, or you need Elrion Rings, or formerly called Elrion Rings, that reduce the amount of mana for your skills. These mods are typically usually expensive when paired with other good mods and can limit the amount of stats you get on those pieces of gear. On top of the increased cost of having a Zealot's Oath viable build, I actually think it's quite unnecessary to even take this keystone in the first place. If you stack enough increased faster start of energy shield recharge on your rings as well as on the tree, combined with the Vault Discipline aura, you have more than enough regen to never even need this keystone in the first place. Starting off leveling, you're going to want to level as a Scion. First of all, you're going to go and kill Hillock. You're going to run to town. And you're going to buy three things. You're going to buy one wand, two wand, typically green, blue, blue linked, if you can get it. And then you're going to buy Explosive Trap. Continue on to the Mudflats. You're going to use your Explosive Trap to collect all the glyphs and touch the wall. And then you're going to go back to the Tidal Island to go and kill Hailrake. Once you've killed Hailrake, you're going to go back to town, grab your flask. You're going to grab your lesser poison support, and you're going to grab Frost Bomb. You're going to continue on normally until you go and kill Brutus, at which point you're going to pick up Flame Dash, which is very important for making you go faster. After we kill the Act 1 boss Mervile, we're going to return to Act 1, and hopefully you've picked up a Transmute by now. We're going to be buying a Stormbrand gem, and our 3 link for that is going to be Stormbrand Added Lightning Onslaught Support. This 3 link should be able to carry you all the way until level 24, which is where we'll be transitioning to full aura support. The links for this are going to be Generosity, Anger, Wrath, Smite. Please keep in mind you will need some sort of melee weapon to use Smite, so make sure that you're ready to transition off of wands if you're using them at level 24. Once you have this 4 link up and running, there should be plenty of damage for you and your carry just to cruise on through the campaign, and you shouldn't really need to make any changes until you're able to add an extra aura after the Sovereignty cluster. The next aura you're probably going to want to run is actually Grace. I think it's a very great defensive aura to run early, and it can provide a lot of tankiness, especially while doing Labyrinth. You will have enough mana to run another aura after you do the Wings of Vestiri quest in Act 9, which gives you the Conqueror's Efficiency Jewel. Once you have this jewel, it's the perfect time to proceed on to the Cruel or Second Labyrinth, which will unlock your first Ascendancy subclass, the Necromancer. The Necromancer subclass gives us our first real big power spike as a support, giving us 3% to attack and cast speed per aura we cast. From here, we're just really running around with our carry, just farming up a bit until we're ready to make the transition to Energy Shield. Right around when you're hitting level 68, it's a great time to go back into the campaign and collect all of the regret point quests that you might have skipped in the past. You're also going to need to buy a few uniques to get started on your transition to ES, the most mandatory of which include Solaris Lyrica and Eye of Chiula. The rest of your gear for now can be filled out with random high ES items you can buy for maybe 1 ALK to 1 Chaos. Prism Guardian and Alpha's Howl can be quite hard to obtain this early on in the league, especially if you are ahead, so you might need to be just running budget gear until you're able to acquire these two particular items. This also leads into our next section, which is gearing for endgame or midgame. Okay, so let's start off with mandatory uniques. These items here are items that pretty much any functional support build will be using. The Prism Guardian and the Alpha's Howl, that's the helmet and the shield, will help us with our mana reservation reduction. This allows us to run more auras. The Solaris Lyrica, or Chevron's Wrappings, the upgraded version, will prevent the chaos damage from bypassing our energy shield to our life bar. This allows us to run all of our auras on life, which allows us to run much more auras than normally possible. The Eye of Chiula, or the Presence of Chiula, provides us with stun immunity, which I find quite important on these support builds to prevent you from getting stun locked. The upgraded version also gives you a lot of chaos resistance, as well as converting some of your life to energy shield. The weapon, the Ephemeral Edge, is best in slot for energy shield. It gives you 50% increased energy shield, which is just great for increasing your overall life pool. Okay, moving on to rings. This particular gear slot is probably where you have the most amount of choice on what you run. There are plenty of viable options, rare and unique, so it's really up to you. And also the economy, how expensive items are, can dictate what you actually want to run. Starting off with rare rings, these can usually offer the best stats, but they're the hardest to find just because they're a little bit niche. Just start out by looking for high ES, possibly the Temple Hybrid mod, even though I don't think they're available in the new leagues. High life is nice because it is converted using our amulet, the Presence of Chiula. Chaos resist implicits are also nice just to help us get chaos capped, which really helps us for beyond maps. The craftable mod for faster start of energy shield recharge is also very strong when it's stacked from all sources. You can get them on the tree, essence surge nodes, you can get them from a watcher's eye, which is a discipline mod, and then you can also get two of them crafted on your rings. And all of those crafted together makes it so your ES recharge time is very low. Moving on to Lori's Lantern, this is just a great choice for early league and even into endgame. I cannot say enough good things about this ring and how good this ring actually is for the price. It's usually 1 ALK, if that. I'm not going to delve too deep into the mechanics of how this ring actually works, but essentially the way it works is it, whenever you take a damaging hit, the ring will roll twice. So let's say that you're taking a hit of lightning damage, which is 1 to 100. The roll will roll twice, and then the game will take the lowered value. And this helps reduce a lot of spiky damage from things like bearers, other sorts of damage, and it will really help you from just getting burst 100 to 0. The Pariah is definitely a solid choice for a ring. It just gives you a plus 100 energy shield. You're going to make it a blue socket, and then it just gives you 5 to 10 cast speed. It's definitely nothing amazing. It's nothing to scoff at. It's just a very solid, unique ring. Depending on what league mods are active, it can be very expensive or very cheap, so you need to maybe look at the price before making that determination. Last up is the Chevron's Revelation Ring. You might see a lot of people using this. I personally hate it. On one hand, you have 3% regen, which I don't think is worth a ring slot at all. And on the other hand, it completely removes your ability to regen at all, which I don't think is good either. I would avoid this at all costs. I really don't like this ring. You should definitely skip this ring. Go for a rare instead. You can get a lot more. Moving on to gloves. I would say that there's only one really good unique you can use in this particular build, and that is Voidbringers. Only because it has plus 1 socketed to level elemental gems in the mods, and then also they can be corrupted for either plus 1 to all gems, or plus 2 to socketed aura gems. It also has a decent chunk of ES. It's like 120 to 130 if they're qualitied. And then double corruptions are also available, so you can get up to maybe a level 27 Wrath or Smite, which is very, very powerful offensively. Your other option would be to just use a pair of rare gloves that have a high amount of energy shield. Obviously, this is a better defensive option, but it doesn't really give you as much power as the Voidbringer does. Moving on to belts, we have two options here. One of them is more defensive and the other one is strictly offensive. The defensive option, Bated Breath, just gives us a lot of energy shield. It also increases our energy shield recharge rate. It is very easy to acquire. You can get it very early on in the league, and it is also very cheap, typically costing maybe one chaos if you get it really early, or one alc later on in the league when there's a surplus. There is an offensive option you can go for, which is the String of Servitude. There are a couple options here which you can go for. Wrath, I think, gives you the most damage, but also Anger and Zealotry are also viable options. String of Servitude are generally underpriced. You can maybe snipe one of these up for maybe like an Exalt for a perfect roll, which will bring a very, very noticeable DPS increase to whoever you're supporting. This brings us to boots. There are two unique options which I usually take. One of them being the Syntrek. It gives us a lot of evasion and energy shield, also some dexterity, which can save us a passive point on the tree. It is a good amount of movement speed. These are usually very cheap, and they were 1 to 2C, but ever since Synthesis, I think this item got a lot more popular, so they are more expensive. Stepinards are also a nice choice, especially if you're doing a lot of beyond. Being immune to the desecrated ground can be really, really, really nice quality of life, as well as it gives you a sizable chunk of energy shield, albeit not as high as Syntrex. Rare boots are also a viable option, however, they typically don't give you very much more than Syntrex or Stepinards would, so you're probably better off spending a little bit less and buying one of these unique pairs of boots and maybe looking for a good corruption rather than spending a little bit more on a rare piece of boots. The flask setup for an aura support starts with a soul catcher alongside a quicksilver and then three elemental flasks. Soulcatcher can be upgraded to Soul Ripper, however, it is usually cost prohibitive and doesn't give you that much more uptime on your Vol auras. An Alchemist Quicksilver of Adrenaline is also imperative to try and keep up with your carry. And to round out your last three flask slots, you do want three elemental flasks. That is Ruby, Sapphire, and Topaz flasks. It doesn't really matter which suffix goes on which flask, but you do want all three of the following suffixes, which is Bleed, Staunching, Curse, Warding, or Ignite, Dousing. As for the prefix, I personally really like Experimenters, so you can have higher uptime on them, but Alchemist also works and will reduce the fire, lightning, and cold damage taken with each flask. In a racing scenario, a silver flask with Onslaught can also be used to try and keep up with the carry. However, in a magic finding scenario, it is completely not necessary and you'll have enough movement speed without it. Okay, now that we have all of our gear down, we can move on to the topic of gem links and aura priority. Once you make it to endgame and you have enough aura reservation reduction, there is a little bit of choice in which auras you'd like to run and whether or not you'd balance offense versus defense. However, there are a lot of auras that you should be running regardless. The following are auras which I consider to be mandatory auras, or auras you should be running regardless of the carry's build. Wrath, Anger, Smite, Grace, Discipline, Haste, as well as the triple purity setup, which is typically in your helmet. Once you have all of these mandatory auras up and running, you can choose to add either more defense or offense. The defense comes in the form of a curse, enfeeble, and then temp chains, or you can choose to run even more offensive auras, such as zealotry, if your carry is perhaps playing a spell build. What you run past these mandatory auras is really up to you. It depends a lot on what you're doing and what your party composition is. Just know that there are a lot of options in the form of curses and extra spell damage auras that you can run. However, I will say that if you are the only support in the party, I highly recommend going for a dual curse setup in the form of Enfeeble and Temp Chains instead of trying to add any extra auras on top of this. The next topic of discussion is going to be movement skills. You're going to see a lot of debate on whether or not people like to use phase run versus shield charge in these kind of builds. I think a big factor in choosing which kind of movement skill you're going to use also comes down to what map you're going to run. For example, shield charge can be much better in very large outdoor layouts such as Estuary. However, Underground Sea being the meta right now, phase run can be a much better skill indoors. There are a lot of ways to squeeze movement speed into a build like this. First off, getting quality on phase run gives you a flat 10% movement speed at 20 quality. On top of that, the phase run can be linked to an enhance to increase the quality, which then increases the movement speed at which you run. Additionally, getting a Watcher's Eye that has an increased movement speed while affected by Grace is a great option if you're having trouble keeping up. In general, you should be straying towards Phase Run if it's an indoor meta, such as Underground Sea, or if it's an outdoor meta, you should be straying towards Shield Charge. Both of them are fine options, and it really depends on what kind of a layout you're running. However, I much prefer the Phase Run setup. Here you can see the run speed of a fully invested Phase Run setup, and it can actually go even faster than a Shield Charge setup with a Bright Beak if properly invested. One of the last things I want to talk about is the Vol Aura choices we have on this build. I strongly advocate people run two Vol Auras, one of them being Vol Discipline and the other one being Vol Grace. You might see a lot of people run Vol Discipline alongside Vol Haste, however, I strongly think that the carry should be running Vol Haste and the support should be running Vol Grace. And the reason for that is scalability. Vol Grace has very high base numbers on dodge and spell dodge, which can be scaled very high with our percentage effectiveness from our aura clusters. This is because Vol Auras are indeed affected to percentage increases in aura effectiveness on the tree. Here you can see the power of Vol Grace. Right now, I have 8% chance to dodge attacks, and that's the only form of dodge that I have. I press the Vol Grace button, and I go to 69% chance to dodge attacks and 61% to dodge spells. And if I activate my Quartz Flask, it goes to 75 and 74. This is just an insane defensive layer, and there's a couple reasons why. The reason that dodge and spell dodge are so powerful is because it rolls first. So let's say an attack is going to hit you, any random attack. It has a 75% chance to be dodged. If that attack makes it through the dodge, then it has to go through evasion. I have 12,735 evasion, which is a 47% chance to evade that attack. So if that attack manages to get through the dodge, then it has to go through the evasion. And then if that attack goes to the evasion, then it has to go through my block, which I don't have very much of that. It's 22%, but it has to go through three stages of things before it can even calculate if it hits me. And then if it makes it through all three of those things, I have an insane layer of tankiness from all of this elemental resistances and my gigantic life pool of energy shield. This is fundamentally why Aurobots with Vol Grace are one of the strongest things in the game. It essentially makes it so nothing can hit you ever if you have Vol Grace up. Vol Discipline, on the other hand, just gives us a very, very hefty regen bonus and makes it so we aren't susceptible to a lot of damage over time effects. That about wraps it up for this video. I think that covers most of everything regarding playing Sion support in a party. If you do have any questions or anything I might have missed in this video, just leave a comment. I'll try and answer anything you might have. And I do stream on Twitch every league with my team. I'll leave a link in the description of that as well. And I hope you guys learned something in this video. Thanks for watching.